Amen. So Paul recognized. Now also Paul in 1 Corinthians told all the women in church to be silent. You gotta know a little bit about the word to understand all that, okay? It's not all about conscience or whatever. They have a lot of questions going on. You're in the middle of church service, so don't ask questions in the middle of church service. Wait till after. Amen. That's what Paul was trying to say. But Paul did salute all the women in the church in the book of Acts. And you read that in the last few chapters of Acts as he was saluting them. Some of them had churches in their homes, actually. And some of them died for the gospel, persecuted for the gospel. And he honored them and saluted them. And so if you still don't like female preachers, we just say she's going to testify real good this morning. Because we do believe in women testified. Amen. Praise the Lord. Without further ado, come on, Miss Angel.
I was just up there.
I know. Come on. Amen. Preacher's happy now. Go ahead, children, be dismissed at this time. Give our children a big hand.
I will say this, Marshall and Sophia drew me a picture of me that I'm going to frame because they drew me skinny. I'm just going to tell you.
Oh, yeah.
I was happy with that picture, okay?
They were prophesied.
They were prophesied. I really appreciate everybody in the church. Try not to get emotional. Give me a second.
That's okay.
It blesses me just when you guys give me hugs and you just say you're happy to see me. I don't require gifts. This is true. You can ask my kids. They never know what to get me for my birthday, ever. So they've been starting to give me things that I would like to go buy myself. And now they're saying, don't go buy that. I'll get it for you. So I'm like, okay, fine. That's my life. So, but... it's going to be funny, the scripture, when we get into it. Just a second, you're going to laugh, and you're going to mind. But first, Father God, thank you so much for this day. Thank you for everyone that's present. Thank you for all the children. Thank you for all the people that cooked. Thank you for everyone who gave me a gift today, God. My heart is just full, and I thank you for that. Because I know that it's through your love and appreciation that these people are honoring me today. And I thank you that it's through you that it's being done. And that we're not, that I'm, you know, that this is not of myself, God. And I just honor you for being Abba Father. For looking down and seeing who is your sons and daughters. To love, seeing who you love as your sons and daughters. Who you are nurturing as your sons and daughters. And Father, I just thank you. And let the words that come out of my mouth today be the words from the Holy Spirit and from you. And God, move me aside in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Y'all can stay if you want to stand for the reading. The scripture I'm going to open with is Proverbs 27, verse 2. And after we read it, you're going to know why it's going to be funny. Because it says, let another man praise you, and not thine own mouth, a stranger, and not thine own lips. You may be seated. When he asked me if I wanted to speak, I was like, I have no clue what to talk about. You know, I was listening to my Proverbs, and I'm going down, and these verses kept catching me. And I got to thinking, how many, if I have a title, I've got two titles. Me and Xavier were kind of figuring out which one it's going to be. It's either going to be Iron Sharpens Iron, or Are You Satisfied? You can pick whichever one suits you and what I'm going to say. Because... A stone is a heavy weight, is heavy and the sand weighty, but a fool's wrath is heavier than the boat. Wrath is cruel and anger is outrageous, but who is able to stand before envy? Open rebuke is better than secret love. Faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kiss of an enemy is deceitful. I know we don't talk about this a lot, but, you know, have you ever been envious of someone? Oh, be honest. Come on. Have you ever saw someone go through something or get something and you're like, God, why can't that be me? God, why can't that be me? Well, that's got to do with who you are with God. Who have you let yourself become to God? Are you his son? Are you his daughter? Are you his servant? Are you the person that's so scary that you're acting like a slave to God? Think about it. We do these things. We have put ourselves in position with God of identities that are not ours. Our identity is only son or daughter. Our identity is not slave to a master. It's not worker. It's not, I mean, we do work for God, but that's not our identity. And it says, have you ever noticed that sometimes people get upset with you and they don't tell you? I'm gonna raise my hand like 15 times here. People get upset with you and they don't tell you they're upset. They don't tell you why. They just don't say nothing. Or they tell everybody else why they're upset with you. But they don't tell you. Okay? And it says right here, open rebuke is better than secret love. Wrath is cruel and anger is outrageous. Who is able to stand before envy? But the open rebuke, when you are upset with someone, you can go to them in love and say, you know what? This is bothering me. I'm not mad at you. It's just bothering me and I want to get us okay. That's an open rebuke type thing. Versus, you know, I've had so many people that have went and talked about me in a bad way in this town. Y'all will hear it eventually. I have been labeled certain things and they don't know me. Or it's just a cruel thing. Instead of coming to me and having a conversation. Me and Miss Bonnie went to breakfast the other day and we had a conversation about that where people don't go to people anymore, do they? They don't. No one wants to fix things. And in verse 17 of this it says, iron sharpeneth iron. So a man sharpeneth the countenance of his friend. If you are my friend, we should be sharpening one another, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Not cutting one another. Right. Didn't say cut. It said sharpen. Yes. Sharpen is to make you more aware. In verse 20 it says, hell and destruction are never full. So the eyes of man are never satisfied. That's where the are you satisfied part of this comes. Are you satisfied? Because it says here, the eyes of man are never satisfied. I'm satisfied with what God's doing in my life. I have to say that because I got to a place where I am satisfied, but I'm striving for more. Amen. I'm not satisfied to be complacent. I'm not satisfied to just sit and be in the status quo, but I'm satisfied with what he's doing for me or through me. And that's where we have to get, because this says a man's eyes, he's never satisfied. So hell and destruction are never full. If you're never satisfied, you're always wanting more, more, more. How many have heard of the more mentality? You know, I want more, I need this, I need that, I want this, I need that, I need this. I'm gonna kind of tell my grandson a little bit. We had to come up and strike a deal because Nana spoiled him a little bit. Papa says a lot. So he's my firstborn grandson. And so, you know, he's got this special place in my life. And so, and he knows this, which is kind of tricky, because he can say, Nana, I need this. And the word isn't I want, it's I need. Nana hears need. Mm-hmm. Nana's like, you need, you get. Well, Nana got in trouble with Mom and Dad a little bit. Because Mom and Dad are trying to teach grandson to earn what he wanted, not needed, instead of saying, Nana, or sending me a text message with a picture, I really need this. I really need it. And I was like, buying it, sending it to his house. I was shipping it to his house. I was like, and so Mom's like, I can't teach him to do his chores if you keep buying him stuff.
Yeah.
I said, I'm sorry. Because I didn't realize that what he was doing was going to Mom and going, I want this. And she had a plan and a system where he's got to earn it.
Yes.
Right? And we need to earn things in life. We don't need to have everything given to us. Because if you don't understand hard work, you don't appreciate what you get at the end of it. So I'm robbing my grandson of an experience. So I've had to do the hardest thing I could ever do. I had to say no. He sent me a message and he said, can you get me this? And I said, how about this? Me and mom come up with an idea that he could work for me and earn some things. Not real big things that he's wanting. Not the expensive things, but little things. So he spent the night and I gave him some jobs to do and he did them so well. I was shocked. He really wondered what I was going to get. So he got him in, I think Saturday, these little things for his game. It was only like $8, but he worked for that $8. You know? So you got to get satisfied.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying? I swear I could probably spend $5,000 and still not get all the stuff he's wanting. Because he sees it and he's a kid, he wants. And I love him for that, for wanting it and coming to Nana, you know. But Nana's learning, I got to go to mom and dad first because they may have a plan. And that's what we need to do with God.
Amen.
Uh-huh.
Y'all get it?
Yes.
We can't just give. When people come to us or situations come up, we don't just act on them. We need to go to mom and dad, have a father, ask what's his plan. Because you could have caused an issue with me and my daughter if I didn't actually listen to that plan. If I didn't go to her and I didn't hear what she had to say, it could have caused a major problem. Well, same with God. God gets tired of telling me to do something as his child. And you not listening, or you doing it your way, or you doing it the way you think you should. So that's why, when he gave me these scriptures, I was like, God, this, to me, this seemed discombobulated. How do you say it? Discombobulated?
Discombobulated.
Yeah. Jan said. But I can see how he's putting it together because I was like, God, this is not making any sense to me. And so when he told me that, and I thought about my other grandson. He's a little bit different. He wants things, but what he wants is food. He wants food. I kid you not. This boy will go hide food. He will go and raid your food. He will ask for Hunt's Brothers Pizza. That is all he eats when he spends the night with me. I have to go to Piggly Wiggly every time he has a sleepover because he is obsessed with Hunt's Brothers Pizza. So I started realizing, well, he wants Doritos, he wants the pizza, he wants a soda. I think he needs to start earning this stuff because that can't be dinner every time he visits Nana because we're eating something else. You know, I've already prepared, I've got the food cooked, and I'm like, I'm spending extra money to get you this. We gotta work on this. This has got to be something you earn. This is going to have to be a treat when you come.
Exactly.
Not making him happy, just so you know. But the idea is that, hell is so large. And so many times people end up going to hell because they're never satisfied. Never satisfied. Always holding a grudge or they're praising their own selves. How many of you have heard someone say, me, I can do, I can do, I've done? I will say this. I jokingly joke about my jobs in the church, but I don't mind them. I need y'all to know this. Some of them I do, some of them are like, I don't know if I can get it done, but it's not a burden to me is what I want to say. And so if I jokingly talk about my jobs, it's not because I'm trying to pat myself on the back. I would prefer to have sat back there all day and never been recognized. And he knows it. That I don't do compliments well, if that makes sense. But you come up to me privately and hug me, I'm just as happy as I can be. Okay? So, I would rather have someone else praise me and say I'm doing a good job because they see it and they recognize it. And it does give you some validation to know that people are like, hey, you're doing pretty good. You didn't screw it up too bad that time. I didn't screw up the wall that bad. I did the wall. But y'all did mess up on not getting a crown. I don't know what's up with that. So if you'll scoot yourself over to Proverbs 30, father and I have a good time. I'm going to tell y'all, we crack up a lot. I don't know how you can have a relationship with God and not laugh. He is so funny.
Yes.
And especially the way he talks to you. I mean, he made us. He's our father. And yes, he's dad, and yes, he had... What I love about God is that he does... Yes, he is to be respected as royal and this. But he's not to be so respected that he's not a human contact to us. If we can't have that human contact with God, there's no point in serving him.
That's right.
Because the whole point of him making us was the human contact.
That's right.
The communication. The companionship. He sent his son to be human so that we could have that feeling of, now I can reach you. I can touch you. And if you've never watched The Chosen, I recommend you do. Because it makes Jesus so human. I got my teenagers watching it in groups so that they can understand how human he is. And the problem I've noticed in a lot of churches over the years is they've got God so high up. Yes, he's to be respected because he's our Father. He's to be respected because he's God. Jesus is to be respected because he's the Son of God. Y'all were here for the play. You saw the three faces of God. God as human. Well, it was God as king. God as, or Jesus as king, Jesus as God, and Jesus as man in the play. What I like about the way God brought that out in this play is the fact that we forget he was human. If Jesus wasn't human, his stripes would count for nothing for us. If Jesus wasn't human, But Jesus, as human, is our brother. How many of you really accept Jesus as your brother? Think about it. Before you answer, think about how you feel about your brother or your sister in flesh. The ones that I, okay, for me, the ones that I birthed, they have to think about how they feel about each other. How do you think about your brother and sister? How do I think about my brother and sister? Do I really accept Jesus as my brother? I have a hard time with that. Because sometimes I'm like, but you're God. And he's like, but I'm human. But you're God, but I'm also human. But you're God, but I died the human death. He didn't die a God death. He died a human death.
Yes.
So we need to take the time to get to know Jesus as our brother and our friend. I went a lot of years thinking... I went a lot of years thinking that God was so unattainable, that he didn't love me enough, because he couldn't, because I wasn't worthy of that. God couldn't possibly love me. He couldn't forgive me because I was nothing to forgive. How many of you have felt that way about yourself in one way or another? That God could not forgive you. Because, and then when you accept that God can forgive you, and you accept that he is your father, do you forget about Jesus? See, it's a three in one, guys. It's a three in one. You can't have one without the other two.
That's right.
That's right.
They're a package deal.
Yes.
And without that package, the relationship's not there. You can't just have a relationship with God without Jesus, and you can't wait. You definitely can't have a relationship with God without Jesus. But you can't just have one with him without Jesus or without the Holy Spirit. You can't have one with the Holy Spirit without Jesus or God. You can't have one with Jesus without God and the Holy Spirit. If you don't have a relationship with all three at some point in your life, you don't have a relationship. That's word. Now, in chapter 30, verse 5, it says, every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. How many of you trust him? I'm learning. See, I'm going to share something with y'all. Today is my earthly dad's birthday. He's in heaven, hopefully. So, still hoping on that. I'm believing he's there. he died in a coma, but I believe that he was led to Christ by me because of the reaction of the doctors and everything. Today's his birthday, so I kind of hijacked his birthday a little bit today, and I didn't mean to, it kind of just happened. He's the reason I didn't trust God, because I couldn't trust my own father. How many of you have had a parent or that you couldn't trust? You didn't trust them to keep you safe. You didn't trust them that they would hurt you. You didn't trust them that they would do what was best for you. That's what I did. So it broke my trust with God. When it broke it before it ever started. That trust was broken before I ever even knew who God was, because it was broken in the physical. And so when your earthly parent breaks your trust and you feel like you just feel like something's wrong, you know? It's harder to let yourself trust God. It's taken me years. 35 to be exact. Wow. Y'all get that joke in a minute. To trust God. Because it's an everyday thing. I have to wake up every day and remind myself that I trust Him. Now, I may not like it, but I got to trust Him. So we're going to move on to the next part of this. Is something He really shared with me. He said, there's a generation that curses their mother and their, or a generation that curses, verse 11, there's a generation that curses their father and doth not bless their mother. There is a generation that are pure in their own eyes and yet not washed from their filthiness. There is a generation, how lofty in their eyes, and their eyelids are lifted up. There is a generation whose teeth are as swords and their jaw teeth as knives, to devour the poor from off the earth and the needy from among men. The horse leech hath two daughters crying, give, give, and there are three things that are never satisfied, yea, four that say it's not enough. The grave is never satisfied, the barren womb is never satisfied, nor that the earth that is not filled with water is never satisfied, and the fire is never satisfied. None of them say it is enough. We're in that generation now. We're in that generation where parents that are trying to be good parents. My generation was the generation where the parents and even the kids treated the parents bad. So this is not just on the parents, guys. My generation, I'm going to call it the 80s, 70s/80s generation. I don't know what we're called. What are we called? Are we Generation X or we're X? That makes a lot of sense. We're X'd out. Okay. So we are Generation X because we don't know nothing. It makes me think of Elon Musk and what he did with Twitter. So I don't want to be X. I'm going to change that. I'm going to be Generation A. So the way we were treated as kids, we older people in this room, the way we were treated as children by our parents was not godly for a lot of us. Let's be honest. How many had an alcoholic parent? How many had an abusive parent? How many were sexually abused by their parent? How many were mentally abused on a daily? So we have to overcome all that to come to this. Now, my daughter's generation is what, Z? Y'all are Z? Are you a millennial or a Z? I don't think you're really a millennial. I think she's kind of a Z/millennial maybe, or whatever. But her generation, they have to deal with everybody saying that all of us got it wrong. Okay? We saw that our parents got it wrong, but nobody said it. Raise your hand if you've ever told your parent they were wrong. I did one time. I did not like it. My mama slapped me so hard. But then her generation comes up and it's saying they got it wrong. They didn't know how to parent because their parents didn't know how to parent, which is true. It's not a lie. It's a true statement. Now, their kids are coming up saying they don't know what they do. You see the pattern?
Yeah.
It don't stop. Satan has set up this pattern to keep telling each generation. The only one that we feared was like 1941 generation, my mom. She slapped the taste out your mouth. His grandma. But I'm saying that generation, you know, we were afraid of them, so we just didn't say it. We sat behind their back and mumbled. We mumbled a lot. So, like you said, there's four things that say there's never enough. The grave, the barren womb, the earth that is filled, not the earth that's dry without water, and a fire is never gotten enough. Have you ever noticed that a fire, when it starts, it don't just stop? It moves to the next thing, and it starts raging and building and building and building until it becomes a raging fire, if it's not under control by humans. But in nature, the fire starts and just keeps growing. It don't just magically put itself out, because it's never satisfied. It wants more. More fuel. More fuel. The devil wants more of us. He wants more fuel to get us. He wants us. He wants us. So just remember those things. I said, I've got one more that I'm going to go over real quick. It is still in verse 30. It is... Let's start at verse 21. For three things, the earth is disquieted, and for four, it cannot bear. For a servant when he reigneth, and a fool when he is filled with meat. For an odious woman when she is married, and a handmaid that is heir to her mistress. There be four things which are little upon the earth, but are exceedingly wise. Take note of this. I'm going to give you four wise things. The ants are a people not strong, yet they prepare meat in the summer. They're smarter than all of us. The conies, which I have to look at what that word is, are but feeble folks, yet they make their houses in the rocks. So they use a strong foundation. The locusts have no king, yet they go forth all by in bands, like being led into army by a king. Because they just know what to do. And it says, the spider taketh hold of her with her hands, and she is in king's palaces. Even kings of this world cannot escape a spider being in their palace. Think about it. We always think of spiders going to the worst places that are dirty or whatever. They're everywhere. Okay? And they live in high life in a king's palace. Think about the food they catch. There be three things which go well, yea, four come. A lion, when he is the strongest among the beasts, and turneth not away for any. A greyhound, a he-goat, and a king, against whom there is no rising up. If thou hast done foolishly in lifting up thyself, or if thou hast thought evil, lay thy hand to thy mouth. In other words, slap yourself in the mouth and say, shut up. Don't be spitting out stuff that's not godly. See how this scripture ties to the first one where it says, the first scripture says, let another man praise thee, and not thine own mouth, a stranger, and not thine own lips. And then in this last verse 32 it says, if thou hast done foolishly by lifting thyself up, or if thou hast thought evil, lay your hand to your mouth. It's okay to be proud of what you do. It's okay to be proud of your accomplishments. It's okay to be proud of everything that God has brought you through and given you the strength to overcome. But when it becomes the I, me show, you in trouble. If you walk in the door and you say, I can do this, I can do that, I've done this, I've lived this, I've done this, I've preached this, I pastored a church, I walked with kings, I was the king's right-hand man, I did this, I did that. All I hear is I. I don't hear anything to God. I don't hear anything about God. I don't hear anything about God saying, you saying, God brought me to this. God blessed me to be the king's right-hand man. God blessed me to pastor. God bless me to run this business. God bless me to play the piano. God bless me to teach. God blesses me to do all 48 jobs, and one of them became a plumber last week. That was a new one. The toilet in the men's room broke, and I had to figure out how to fix it temporarily until the men could come fix it. So my jobs are a joke with my teens and me. It's just a fun thing we do. They just like to sit and count up everything that they hear me do. But it's not the most important thing I do. The most important thing I do is have a relationship with A.
Amen.
With Jesus, my brother.
Yes.
And with the Holy Spirit, my comfort. Without that, guys, we got nothing. You got nothing. You go home the same. You go home empty. You go home blah. There's nothing to help you. You've got to have that. And so with that, I'm going to ask everybody to stand. Because the Holy Spirit has impressed upon my heart that there's some people that are struggling with their relationship with you. Not just Holy Spirit, but with Jesus and with God. You have three to choose from that you can look at and say, how's my relationship? Is your relationship okay with God? Is your relationship okay with Jesus? Is your relationship okay with Holy Spirit? Whoever you need to fix it with, these altars are open. And we can lay hands and anoint you and pray for you that you can, you know, that God can mend this. Cindy, can I borrow you for a minute? There's something I know that you can say that I can't, because I can't remember it rightly. I'm sorry, you have your good. Pray for her. She got a stress fracture. Do you remember the going to say something for me, because I don't want to screw it up, because it's an important statement that has helped me get through. A lot of you I have given the pause act to, and I've shown you how to use it, and it helps when you're really stressed. It helps you connect back with God. Now I would like you to share what it says about healing the union.
Yeah, so with the pause app, it's an amazing tool to use for your daily devotion with the Lord, and it starts out with a prayer just with God, and you ask Him to restore your union. And so as you're breathing in His presence, you're just repeating, Lord, would you, Holy Spirit, Father God, Jesus, will you heal my union with you?
That's what I couldn't remember. Thank you. And that is something we need to do. We need to say this. So we're going to say it together. Ready? Father God,
Father God.
Jesus,
Jesus,
Holy Spirit,
Holy Spirit,
heal my union with you.
Heal my union with you.
Make it stronger.
Make it stronger.
Get out all the bad.
Get out all the bad
that I've allowed in.
That I've allowed in.
Restore.
Restore
my relationship.
My relationship
with you.
With you.
Don't let.
Don't let.
The devil deceive me.
The devil deceive me.
Don't let me be deceived.
Don't let me be deceived.
Give me the courage to stand.
Give me the courage to stand.
On what is right.
On what is right.
No matter what.
No matter what.
Now, if you need prayer today, please come up. The altars are open. This is the time for you and your union with God. This isn't about me. This isn't about Pastor. This is about three identities, or three beings with you. Our Father, our Brother, and our Comforter. If you're not sure about your relationship with Him, I'm telling you, don't leave here today until you've talked to one of them. So let one of them comfort you. If you need prayer, come up and I'll lay hands on you, pray for you. I'll let you know for healing, deliverance, whatever.
Church, you need to talk to the Lord. Like Angel said, we got the anointing all out here. We got
Anybody here sick today, get a touch from the Lord. It says in James chapter 5, call the elders of the church and they'll pray over them. Amen. Healing comes that way. They just spoke about many things. You struggle with forgiveness. Angels are one to talk to. She's had to overcome a lot of obstacles in her family. So if you need forgiveness today, or you need to forgive somebody, today's your day. He's off the trail.
When my way of dreams, precious Lord, linger me when my life is almost gone. Hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand, lest I fall. Take my hand. Precious Lord, lead me home. Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn.
Lead us home.